this mushroom sells at a very premium price in the market. Then what happened? We made a mushroom, not only a right one, but also which was enriched with vitamin D, and also which takes very small time for maturation. We reduced the production time from 1 year to 2 months. So these technologies were with us. But we wanted to now diffuse this technology to the people. So what we did? So our scientists, they interacted with MSME. And through MSME, now we develop series of clusters, and each cluster, at least 200 entrepreneurs are associated. So we have already made around 7-8 clusters, and through that cluster, we transfer technology for shiitake mushroom cultivation, not only in, it is a northeast part, in Sikkim and some other such, in northern eastern part of the nation, we transfer this technology. This was one technology. Then we thought, we also have more technologies. Like, for example, another major issue which our country is focusing is on waste disposal. And particularly organic waste. We generate a lot of kitchen waste. A lot of organic waste is generated. In Lahaul Spiti region, people have problem for degradation of white soil. So our scientists, they developed the right sort of consortium of bacteria. And now they have a production technology. They can go about 1 ton per day or 2 tons per day, that sort of production scale. And then again through MSME, we transfer this technology to northeast part of the country and also in Himachal in Sirmaur region. So already if you go to Sirmaur, you will see we have our common facility center created where entrepreneurs are associated and they are developing all these technologies, right? So in the livelihood generation issues, we transferred our range of technology. So diffusion was the main feature which we performed during this year. Then our scientists said that this Himachal is very suitable for floriculture crops. Again through MSME, they connected around 700-800 farmers together, developed a common production center, and now in floriculture also through MSME, those 800 entrepreneurs, they are being funded and supported and they are generating their livelihood. So livelihood creation, our institute play a very, very significant role through diffusion of several of these technologies. Now, very interestingly, once Honorable Prime Minister mentioned that, India is such a big country, diverse country, we make so many, type of plants, but in honey production, we are still 7-8. Why it is so? Can't we play any significant role? And in that area, then what we did, again, now here the role of engineers became very important, I tell you that, sir. So CSIO is one of our institute. We requested them, can we develop some interesting beehive so that, you extract the honey without killing any larva, without killing any, honeybee. So they made that honey hive for us. And now, through MSME, again, in the Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Rajasthan and Bihar, we made a cluster of around 4,000 people, our scientists. And 4,000 people connected together, they are only entrepreneurs. So they will be having other sub people which are associated with them, honey cluster. We prepared a honey cluster. So through science and technology, unless we diffuse it out to the society, I think our role remains unfulfilled. So we did that. So in honey, in vermicomposting, in shiitake mushroom cultivation, all those technologies we started diffusing. And can you imagine now 6,000 entrepreneurs associated with us? So MSME, we realized it's a very powerful machinery to amplify the technologies, to empower the people. So that's what we did. Then we realized, when we were analyzing some of the things, this country does not grow any honey. And we consume about, last year data was, we import around 1,540 tons of fing in this country. And we spent around 942 crores. And it was a huge sum. And we are the, we received one interesting comment from one of the netier. And he said, hey man, I never realized that my sambar is also imported. And unless the import need is met, my sambar cannot be made. So, such interesting things we listen, and this was covered so well in various news media, like from Guardian to Hindu to BBC. Ultimately, in कौन बनेगा बनेगा करोड़पति, there was a question, and then they said that there is a lab in Himachal which has done that. So it was very interesting, and you know, our scientists got a lot of excitement. Was they succeeded in introducing heme in this country? Here, important thing was that not only we introduced this heme, but we took it to the stakeholder. So it went again to the farmers. So hundreds of farmers are associated with us. Through this state government, and now heme cultivation started in Himachal. So that was a very big achievement this year. Another thing we thought, you know, this country imports around 100 tons of kesar, saffron, and our country hardly grows 9 to 10 tons, that too from around 3,000 hectares, which is again I think reduced to 2,000 hectares in the Pampore area in Jammu and Kashmir. So we said, can't we bring it beyond Kashmir? तो देख पाते केसर को कश्मीर से बाहर लाना है, ये हमारा नारा था. हमने कहा बाहर लेकर आओ, कुछ ना कुछ करना चाहिए. सो टेल यू वन थिंग, यू नो, अपार्ट फ्रॉम सैफरन, अपार्ट फ्रॉम हींग, इन दिस पार्ट ऑफ द कंट्री वी वांटेड टू सी आवर फार्मर्स फ्लरिशिंग, एंड बट वी रियलाइज दैट फार्मर्स हैव लॉट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम विद यू नो वाइल्ड बोर्स, विद रैबिट्स, दे विल कम एंड डिस्ट्रॉय देयर क्रॉप्स. सो अराउंड 4 years बैक वी हैड इनिशिएटेड अ मिशन of aroma mission, that they should grow a crop which these wild animals don't eat, and also the crop which gets fetches them good money. So we gave them wild marigold, which, you know, you eat that kacham, coffee, etc., right? And that flavor of kacham comes from that oil. So I'm just giving you a small example. It is used in several other perfumery also, but as a common thing. Now those farmers today, around 1,000 farmers are associated with us, and they produce around 12 to 13 crore rupees just by sale of those oil, and their income went around 3 to 4 times, right? So those are some of the livelihood issues that our institute talks, tackles and diffuses out into the society. So we have series of some crops. I will not detail on all those crops, but important thing I just wanted to share. And one important thing that we have done this year, that we have introduced floriculture mission. And this floriculture mission, we expect that we will be generating approximately 230 crores or that much amount of money with the farmers. So that is one of our targets. And I think next time when we meet, I think I will be happy to share with some of those achievements. And one last thing I would like to mention, that apart from all the science and technology that our institute works, what we also participate in is skill development program, which are like, for example, in plant tissue culture and other areas. We do that. And building of scientific temperament, that is one of our major issues. And this year it was a COVID time, but in spite of that, we did certain online courses, and more than 6,000 people, they were joined, and you know, a lot of students, they got exposed that what science and technology can do for the society. This year, I am very happy to share one data, that we signed around 83 MOUs only this year, agreements. Out of these 83, 20 were for technology transfer, and around 15 for incubators and startup. And I am very happy to share, and Professor Chandrasekhar ji will also like to listen that, out of the incubators, 9 incubators and startups, they already have their product in the market. So that is a success story. That, you know, giving and generating startup is not important. More important is that, you know, our startups, they are empowered and they start to be putting their products into the market. So that was something interesting I thought I'll share with you. And with all these efforts, our scientists do a lot of good publications. Approximately 100 papers a year with impact, average impact factor more than 3, and highest impact factor touching somewhere 10 or 11. From a biological lab, I think it's quite a decent one. And in the Shimago rating, our institute ranks 9th in the whole CSIR labs. And I think if you talk of only plant sciences lab, then our institute becomes number 1 in that area. So I think that is a great achievement for all of us. So, with this, I would like to end my welcoming address, and I'm happy to share that, so happy to see that Professor Avasthi ji and Professor Chandrasekhar ji with us to give us guidance, to bless us, So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I now invite Professor Lalit Kumar Awasthi to deliver his chief guest lecture on fog computing and challenges.
Good morning and greetings to all present here. Professor Chandra Chakraji, I have been fortunate enough to work with him when he was director at NIT Hamirpur, and we have listened to his illustrated career, and he has been apart from all this, he has been mentor to many scientists and engineers. The director of this institute is Sanjayji, and senior scientists Dipenji and Sashini. Participants and scientists here, first of all, I congratulate to one and all for this celebration of National Science Day. And there have been a lot of good work which this institute has done, and it has been illustrated by Sanjayji, and I congratulate the institute for contributing in the true spirit in which the institutions and the laboratories, scientific laboratories, they need to work. They need to develop technology. You are developing technology. They need to transfer the technologies, you are transferring the technologies, and then they need to build a good, vibrant entrepreneurial system, and that also is being contributed by me. So, I'm representing NIT Hamirpur as well as NIT Jalandhar. NIT Hamirpur has been one of the top institutions in the country for contributing in almost all areas of engineering and technology. And similarly, NIT Jalandhar is also another good institution in the vicinity, and we are contributing almost 11 technological departments. We have every engineering possibility: computer science, electronics, IT, instrumentation control, and civil, mechanical, all. And along with that, we are into science education. We have MSc programs. We have now B.Tech programs also related to physics and chemistry at NIT Hamirpur. And we have PhD in almost all the disciplines. So, of engineering, science and management. Roughly, we have each institute has more than 400 research scholars, and we are making at NIT Hamirpur, we have this CM startup project under which the entrepreneurship work is being done. At NIT Jalandhar, we have a technology business incubation center, DST sponsored project, and we also are one of the leading institutions which has a space technology business incubation center. Sponsored by ISRO. Both the institutions are open to the public, and anyone can come and start. At NIT Hamirpur, we have 7 entrepreneurial initiatives. And at NIT Jalandhar, we have roughly 11 entrepreneur setups which have started, and there are some projects which are coming up with space technology. These are initial. Actually, the manpower which we have is very, very elite and very good. So we have roughly 169 faculty members, all PhD in various areas of engineering, science and technology at NIT Hamirpur. Another 190 PhD people are at NIT Jalandhar. So this is a great research pool. The output of the institution is being reflected in the publication. For example, when I joined NIT Jalandhar, we were able to produce roughly 230-240 peer-reviewed journal publications. This year, the publication of the institute has been 600. It has crossed 600 mark in a year. So, tremendous work is being done. But the only thing which our Honorable Prime Minister or Honorable Education Minister, or which Sanjay ji has said, or Professor Chandrasekhar ji has preached, is that these technological advancement, these research publications, they need to be converted into technologies, and these technologies need to be used for uplifting our country, the great country India. We need to convert these technologies. So that process is started. At NIT Jalandhar, we have transferred four technology. One technology is for purifying of air, which can kill the virus and bacteria. So this is a good initiative, startup which has been transferred to the industry. So many such initiatives are coming up. But having a collaboration with your institute, I think we can have, there is a immense possibility, and we have a department of biotechnology at NIT Jalandhar, and department of chemical engineering, and department of chemistry, which are fully grown, and these departments can come together, and I think we can collaborate and work for the betterment of mankind. So I think there are great possibilities which can be there. Now I have a small presentation on fog computing. So I'll just talk about, and probably if someone can get some idea, or they can use in their research, probably it's going to be good. So we have been listening to cloud computing and things like that. I think biologists have also seen there have been immense developments which have come in the area of computer science, and computer science and engineering is touching all the areas. So it's not only limited to computer, but it is now in almost every area. We have machine learning algorithms, we have artificial intelligence, we have things like that, which are inroads into every area. So similarly, this is related to the computing power. We are talking of computing power and fog computing. We were having small computing devices, then we thought of having a cloud. So cloud is a big data center kind of thing, which is accessible directly. Now, what happens is that there can be the applications which require immediate access. So those in the cloud, we cannot guarantee output within a small time. So we have another solution, and that comes up as the fog computing. So again, greetings. Now this is how we go from introduction, history, and why do we need the fog computing. I talk of fog architecture. How does this fog work, and then we talk of fog versus cloud, benefits, some research challenges, application, and conclusion. So, does Cloud computing is a distributed computing paradigm that extends the services of the cloud to the edge of the network. So there is a possibility of centralized means one, and distributed means it is distributed over a geographical area. And fog is based on the idea of enabling computing directly at the edge of the cloud infrastructure rather than being transmitted to the core of the cloud. So as I told you, cloud is somewhere a centralized computing facility. Fog acts as an intermediate layer in between cloud, data centers and IoT devices, sensors, and provide computation network and storage facility. So maybe the system which we can think is having IoT devices or sensors attached, and they may be attached to some plants or something. The application area directly that can be assessed is by sensors or IoT devices, and from there we can have the computation power of fog. This is the three essential attributes. The horizontal architecture supports multiple industrial application domains. Cloud to things continuum, the services distributed closer to the things. So if I say IoT, so IoT is very close to the application, and then the fog is also very close to the sensor or the device which is talking to a real time phenomenon. You can have a temperature sensor, and then the readings are taken by a machine at the edge of the cloud. Then that is possibly the, if that is processed there, that is fog computer. And the system level, the fog computers as a system level, it extends from the things over the network edges to the cloud and across multiple protocol layers. Fog computing is used for IoT, 5G and AI applications with need scale. And scale is security, additional security to ensure safe, trusted transactions. Cognition, awareness of client-centric objectives to enable autonomy. Agility, rapid innovation and affordable scaling under a common infrastructure. Latency, real-time processing and cyber-physical system control. Efficiency, pulling of local unused resources from participating end-user devices. So history, the concept of fog computing was first introduced by Cisco in 2012. To address the challenges of IoT application in conventional fog computing. Cisco recently delivered the vision of fog computing to enable applications on billions of connected devices already connected to the Internet of Things to run directly at the network edge. In 2015, Cisco, ARM, Dell, Intel, Microsoft, and Princeton University, they founded the Open Fog Consortium, and then there were some World Congresses on fog, and the Open Fog Consortium was with the Industrial Internet Consortium in 2019. Why do we need fog? Existing cloud models are not designed for the volume, variety and velocity of data that is being generated by IoT devices. The Internet of Things is that any device can talk to the Internet. So if you have a podium, you have a mobile phone, you have sensor, they can talk to the internet, and they generate a lot of data. A lot of bandwidth is needed to move the tremendous data generated by IoT devices to the cloud for analysis. International Data Corporation predicts that by 2025, nearly 45% of world data will be moved closer to the network edge. So what happens is, in a cloud infrastructure, all the data goes to the data center, to the cloud. Whereas in the edge, we can compute it on the device which is very near to the IoT device. Fog is the only architecture to withstand this amount of data. This is the fog architecture. We have a cloud layer at the center. At the top, you can see this is a big data center, and then there is a fog layer. And at the last is the end layer. The IoT devices are generating data which goes to the fog layer, and only the data which is not that much time sensitive, they get that can be sent to the data center. Otherwise, it can be processed at the fog moment. So, this will enhance the speed and also the volume of data which is sent back to the cloud that can be limited. We have the architecture end layer. This is the layer closest to the end user, and and cochlea. This layer is located on the edge of the network and the cloud. It consists of multiple high-performance servers, storage devices. So how does fog work? The nearest fog node, the devices, they generate the data, and then there is an aggregate fog node which can send the summary of historical analysis and storage to the cloud. Otherwise, we can have that the time-sensitive data that will be taken here by the nearest fog node only. The developers either code or write IoT application for the fog node. The fog node closest to the network edge ingests the data from the IoT devices. Then the fog IoT device application directly directs different types of data to the optimal place. Most time-sensitive data which should be analyzed within a fraction of a second, analyzed at the nearest node, send the decision or action to the devices, send and store the summary to the cloud for the future analysis. Less time-sensitive data, the data which can be analyzed after seconds or minutes, sent to aggregate node for analysis. After analysis, the aggregation node sends the decision or action to the device to the nearest node. Aggregate node sends the summary to the cloud for storage. And the non-time-sensitive data, this data which can wait for hours is sent to the cloud for storage and analysis. So you can analyze it. If there is a time-sensitive data, you can use the fog architecture. So it's a kind of hybrid architecture. At the back end we have the cloud, and at the front we have the fog. So fog node closest to the IoT devices, and fog aggregation node and then the cloud. The response time in milliseconds or small, then it is given to the fog node. And if it is in seconds to minutes, then it is given to the aggregation fog node. And otherwise, if beyond that, it is sent to the cloud. Similarly, the applications, there can be machine-to-machine communication or telemedicine and training, then it is the fog node which is required to process the data. Otherwise, for visualization, it can be fog aggregation node, and for big data analytics, we can send the data to the cloud. So similarly, the storage, transit storage can be done at this fog node, and we can keep the data for a smaller duration at fog aggregation node, or otherwise we need to send it to the cloud. Geographic coverage, it's very local at fog node, wider and cloud we can have global geographic coverage. Fog versus cloud, fog platform receive feed from IoT devices using any protocol in real time, run IoT enabled application for real time control and analytics with millisecond response time, send periodic data summaries to the cloud. And the cloud platform, it receives and aggregates data, summarizes from many fog nodes, perform analysis on IoT data and data from other sources, then send new application rules to the fog node based on the insights. This is again a comparison of many metrics, latency, real-time interaction, mobility, location awareness, geographic distribution, distance to the end devices, location of services, bandwidth costs, computation and storage, energy consumption. So these are cloud versus fog. For example, latency, if it is high, it can be cloud, otherwise it will get fog nodes. Similarly, for energy, if high energy is required, the application network is going to be cloud. Benefits, ultra low latency, less bandwidth than network load, better security, business agility, real time analytics, and it's reduced cost. The research challenges, resource management is a challenging issue in fog computing, as nodes have limited computational capability and are restricted by various energy constraints. It is difficult for fog devices to match the resource capability of the cloud. thereby demanding a judicious management of resources. So if application is data intensive, then probably we need to go for cloud instead of farm. And then for computing, energy efficient solutions are required to minimize the impact of fog computing on the environment. Placement of fog nodes closer to the renewable energy resources can be one of the solutions. Interoperable architecture of fog nodes. Fog nodes perform traditional networking activities as well as computation tasks. In real-time scenario, fog nodes act as the computational devices, whereas in other cases, the networking capabilities of fog nodes become more prominent. Therefore, an interoperable architecture that can serve customized requirements is an important issue. And we have mobile fog computing. Mobility of fog nodes would make resource availability, resource discovery, resource provisioning, and task offloading even more challenging, because the nodes will be connecting from A location, B location, C location, then they need to connect back to the cloud and then find out the appropriate resources. And we have the security and privacy. The location of fog node closer to the user require designing strong access control policies for fog node. Enforcing security protocols over a distributed system such as fog is an important challenge. Reliability, since fog computing is the integration of large number of geographical distributed devices and connection, reliability is a prime concern. As I said, this is a service level agreement, and these agreements come into force between the users and the cloud, or between the users and the fog. So, fog system can have multiple providers and can span across multiple domains, therefore defining new SLAs for fog system is also a challenging task. Scalability, most of the existing algorithms for fog do not scale to the magnitude of IoT networks. So, IoT is Internet of Things, and as I told you, everything which we use can be on Internet. So, and they will be periodically generating the data. So the capacity at the rate at which the data is generated and how much data the fog node can handle, that is also, and that can create some problem. Real fog environments. Currently there exist two infrastructure options for real fog computing. Many researchers rely on simulation studies, so effort to build a realistic large-scale fog test bed is required. Bandwidth aware fog system. So the bandwidth is the main constraint, and we need to look into whether the bandwidth which the application require, if it is less, then probably we can send it to maybe cloud, but if it is more and we are not able to provide that, then we have to kind of plan. Fog node site selection. So finding appropriate location for deploying the fog node is also important. We need to look for something, a common place where we can act to many IoT devices simultaneously. These are some of the applications which have been listed. They can, you have some interest. The smart city, we are using technology to deal with many challenges. Various aspects where fog computing can impact the smart cities. Intelligent city, a city with the smart parking, shopping and infrastructure. So every parking place can have a smart IoT device which can tell which slots are available and which slots are not available. Similarly, shopping, infrastructure, intelligent hospital, linking all aspects for greater patient care and healthcare devices. Most of you might be having this, the smart watches, the data produced by the watch from your watch. So it is at what time period we are sampling your data, and then that data is provided to the doctor or hospital through the nearest fog node. Intelligent highway system, intelligent factories. So this is one example of smart cities where the fog computing can help. Smart cars and traffic control. So in 2016, the average person created around 650 MB of data every day. And by 2021, it will almost double. So you can see how much data is being generated. And then you require the capacity, capability to handle this data, depending upon how many persons are there. So autonomous cars will generate terabytes of data every day from the combination of lie detection engine, global policing system, cameras, etc. A cloud only model will not be efficient for autonomous transport, so we can use the flight fog computing for this. This is an example of smart cars and traffic control systems. You can have sensors in various traffic lights and vehicles talking to each other, meeting between vehicle networks. Then we have smart healthcare. Healthcare system face enormous challenges like nursing staff shortage, demand to reduce cost. Sensor devices are often not powerful enough to do such computation on their own. Cloud computation is not a suitable solution for such offloading. And then, again, it can use the fog architecture. So, this is a smart care system where the data where it is generated, the nearest to fog computing node can help. Smart grid, in a large smart grid, smart meters produce tremendous amount of data that are hard to process, analyze and store. So the solution can be the smart grid is the only place to integrate green power resources into the energy distribution. Fog computing is an environment that offers a place for collecting, computing and storing the smart meter. This is another application. Smart security and surveillance. Security and surveillance is at the top everywhere. And if you want, again, these cameras and these security devices, they will be generating a lot of data. Again, it will be easy to handle it at the edge of the network instead of sending it to the cloud. So biotechnology, I have just put one or two slides there. There are the growing privacy concerns on the village leader on top of the bioinformatics researchers need to port their data and algorithms to the cloud environment in order to perform analysis and predictive results. The emerging trend of on-the-fly solution for bioinformatics problem as well as the demand for more and more real-time applications requires bringing the computational resources closer to the user, and that is done by having the fog computing devices. But definitely, it will depend upon how much computational power you need. If the more computational power is required, probably you need to send it to the cloud only. So these are some of the applications as have been discussed, you know, genomics and personalized medicine. You can take these decisions at the edge of the network. So fog computing is the missing link to accelerate the IoT growth. Fog computing is the cloud companion to handle 2 exabytes of data generated daily from the Internet of Things. Fog computing accelerates awareness and response to events by eliminating a round trip to the cloud for devices. Ultimately, organizations that adopt fog computing gain deeper and faster insights, leading to increasing business ability. I think having hybrid of fog as well as cloud can have. If you have a good data center at the back end and the front end, the computing devices can solve your problem. Locally generated data can get some responses. Probably that is going to help. And probably it may have some applications in your plant research as well. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, Professor Awasthi, for such a mysterious and informative lecture on fog computing. I hope we are going to use this information in our experimental work, especially in computational biology. Thank you so much, sir. Moving forward, it's time for distribution of certificates to the participants of Student Seminar Series 2020. I will request Dr. Nihal again to facilitate the distribution and let us know about genesis of Student Seminar Series. Was basically guided by our director sir, and it is solely done by the students themselves. We started the student seminar series in the year 2017 as a means of promoting interdisciplinary research. The students know what activities are being carried out across disciplines, and such they generate and develop relationship amongst ourselves with respect to scientific deliberations. Each year, the student seminar series is conducted on 5th of September, marking the Teachers' Day. So the students, in a way, honor the mentors also. And at the same time, each year, a theme is assigned to the student seminar series. And this year, it was COVID-19, a cancel culture or a window of opportunities. So the students believe that COVID-19 provides far more opportunities to us such that we can strive in our scientific endeavors. While our prior student seminar series was limited to the students of this organization itself, in this year we have participants from across borders, that is USA also. So we spanned the boundaries. We had participation from IIT Mandi, IIT Roorkee, Shulini University, Punjab University, and of course from ISBT. So there were a total of 20 speakers. We had presentations and photography competition in this program, sir. We had 20 presentations. 5 were invited lectures that included MD doctors who were dealing with COVID situation from Mandi Government Hospital, sir. And then there were Ayurvedic doctors from Paprola College who were trying to explain us how we should, what is the COVID appropriate behavior and how we should move around. And we also have some of the technical persons from this institute who guided us as to how COVID-19 testing is done. So it was whole and whole an amalgamation and a learning for the students and the staff as well. Coming on to the participants, I will name the participants and request the people backstage to bring on their certificates. So we start with the certificates for the participants. We have only the participants also. It is Ajay Kumar. Anita Kumari. We have Himani Agarwal. May I request you to make it faster, please? Gautam, Savita Chaudhary, who participated and made deliberations are no more in this institute, so I will name them. It was G. Sai Venkat and Khem Singh. And these presentations were evaluated and we have winners too. The first prize went to Ravindra from IIT Roper, so he won't be present physically. I would request Vijay Bhartwaj, who won the second prize. And as our director sir was saying, that tea is beneficial in combating COVID-19. So his title was Therapeutic Potential of Tea Against COVID-19, a bioinformatics approach. The third prize was shared between Pariniti from Shulini University. She won't be here, but I request Abhishek, who also won the third prize in a combined way, and his title was Enzyme and COVID-19. Congratulations for the prize. One of our technical officers, he presented how RT-PCR with regard to COVID-19 is done. I would request Dr. Anish Kalsa to please collect his certificate. He presented real-time QRT-PCR in COVID-19. We also had photography competition in which we had 15 participants. From this institute, the first prize went to Aki Pipal. He had a photograph of a tree in a dark background. I'm unfortunately not able to show the photograph. Nonetheless, it was a beautiful one. The second prize went to, in a combined way, to Vasant Kumar from HPU, but also Sumit from IHPT. So it is a means of promoting observation of nature and developing skills of capturing nature with your camera. We do not have Rishabh Sharma with us. He won the third prize. Nonetheless, we are giving a special prize to Anita Kumari for a beautiful film. Sir, as I mentioned, this student seminar series is conducted solely by the students, so there has to be a backbone. So, I would now announce the name of the conveners who made this seminar series possible during this time. I name them in alphabetic order. Alpi Sharma. These are the conveners who convened this student seminar series. Aman Verma. Anish Tamar, Supriya Sharma, Vikas Tarwar, one more, Amit Kumar. Achha, he's present. I was told he's absent. Okay, that's great. Amit Kumar. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for that.
Achha, Arti Sharma.
Okay. I somehow missed the name of Arti Sharma. My apologies. I will request Arti to please collect the name.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Unnayan.
And thanks to Professor Avasthi and sir. Now I request our guest of honor, Professor Chandrasekhar, for his address. Professor. Professor Chandrasekhar ji, kindly adjust your camera so that we can see your face. Now it's okay, sir. Now it's okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, now you can start.
Are you hearing my voice?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Very well, sir.
It's audible, sir.
Some echo is coming, sir.
Here the voice is clear, sir.
Can you make my correction?
Yes,
sir.
Yes,
sir. Hello.
Sir, we are
trying to
do
it. I can talk, but...
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
I think
very well audible, sir. Very well audible.
Because just after hearing the writer, I realized I changed my life to talk about the Science Day. Because two things. Let me tell you, everybody in this country, every scientist, every technologist in the country know why the Science Day is celebrated. But let me tell you what is the purpose of this. It is not clear to everybody. It is created to inspire passion for science. In teachers, scientists, students. That is the main purpose actually for this. And science, though it is defined in many ways, but science is one of the most important channels for knowledge. It has a specific role. As well as variety of functions for benefit of our society. Creating new knowledge, improving education, and improving the quality of human life. Science must respond to the social needs and global challenges. I found that in this institute, for the scientific achievement, they're definitely addressing the social needs. But let me give one more thing. Without science, there is no human growth, no technological advances. No technological advances has in whether it's a cloud computing or it's a fog computing, if you are not developing science, it will stay near there. Science is knowledge. And without investment in science, the whole world, as we know, it would not be possible. As we know at present. Without science, the world would stop. Why I am telling like this? You are seeing in this pandemic what has happened. We were not taking medicine and everything stopped. Some people say the social sciences are not essential. They are very essential, I can tell you. Without the social sciences, world would become barbarian. So we have to know our culture, our history, all. Now the question comes, can humans survive without science or technology? The answer is easy. Most of us would die within few days or few months or few years. Because many diseases are coming, if we are not finding the solution to them, we cannot exist, we cannot. So, without scientific tools, human race would extinct within a year. Every scientist should see about it, that what is happening. We have to combine the traditional science and knowledge of modern science to save human beings. Now I would like to, because I have heard very, very nice things from the director, what is being done there. First of all, I would like to congratulate the director and the scientists of the institute for giving a very comprehensive, in a very comprehensive way, the work of the institute. But since I work with light, I would like to suggest something which I have not seen in this talk. Maybe some scientists may already be working. We are living in a light. This light we are getting from sun, from the stars, from moon. I would like to talk 1 or 2 minutes. Role of light in plant growth. Every agriculture scientist or every biological scientist, they know. I have also read when I was there for 10th class student. It is essential for photosynthesis. Mm-hmm. But what it can do for us, excellent. A general thumb rule is that 1% light will give you a similar percentage increase in the plant growth. Resulting in 1% higher yield. So can we control the light in such a way so that we can get the higher yield? All plants require light and CO2 for photosynthesis. This is what we read at the school level. Whatever I have understood or I have studied last many years, without appropriate lighting, plants would not be able to produce energy it needs to grow. Now the question comes, what is the appropriate? This is a very important question, let me tell you in science. What is that appropriate level? That scientists have to find out for every plant, for every fruit, for every vegetable. This, I was visiting about 5-6 years back, a university, Eindhoven University, in Netherlands, which is the city where the Philips is located. And there I found some research was being done, how to increase the yield of the tomato by using a particular wavelength of light. At that time I started thinking, particular kind of light can increase the plant growth and yield. Now how to get it? In a cheap way, because agriculture is not a industry like business where you can put a lot of money, or it is not a scientific study where a lot of money is put, or technological study where a huge amount of money is put. When I was working in industry to run an aerodynamic system, he was spending many lakhs of rupees to get the aerofoil or aeroprofile of the turbine blades. In those days, the budget of BHEL corporate R&D was 110 crores rupees, R&D only. Now it is spoiled. The government spoiled many systems. At that time, when I was thinking, when these colored LEDs were made, then white LED came. In that, if you do it properly, technology if you do properly, you can enrich them with a particular value. One has to, once a scientist who is working on a plant, fruits, or vegetable on herbs, he can see the absorption characteristic of these plants. And then one can choose particular LEDs, which may help, because there may be a cheaper solution. Some people may say the laser can be used. Yes, laser can be used, but a very costly solution, which will not work for the agriculture purpose. This type of, I think it might have already been done in this institute, but if it is not being done, then the possibility should be examined. I am not telling please do it. Examine the possibility, if it can help you. To develop, you see, science is very much required to develop a very good class of engineering or technology. Light can be used there also. Professor Avasthi has talked about internet, IoT, about cloud computing, about fog computing. Yes, the synthesis of both will work in future. But first our scientists should understand very clearly, if they want to do something in that, what is the contribution of Sir Isaac Newton, Christian Hygiene, Max Planck, Albert Einstein, Neil Bohr, Dinkowski, Heisenberg, Dirac, Feynman, and many others. I am not remembering the name of all that friend, since I am talking extempore. It may be a little unconnected, but please bear with it, because I changed my mind, which I was to talk, I have stopped there. I want to talk only about which is useful for this institution. You see, at present in the world, very good experiments are being done on photons. It has not ended with Einstein or somebody. A few months back, an experiment is done in NIST, National Institute of Standards, in Maryland, United States, that you can make two photons out of one photon. By passing them through a crystal. Then two you can change in four. Means you can change the frequency of the light. This definitely will help us to make just to make optical internet. Professor Avasthi should think about it in his institute, because he is leading two institutes at present. I don't know whether you are any people who can work in that direction or not, but definitely a thought should be given to it that quantum bit technology can be used by using photons, by using polarized photons to create optical internets, optical connectivity. It will be difficult to hack them, because you only know what type of polarization they have used. So I think our Indian scientists who are working in technology, they should think about it. And about this light. Light is very essential for human behavior, because ultimately we are working with human beings. Himalaya is a place where very knowledge is generated in very deep, and it has flown from Himalayas to place. At present, from last 100 or 200 years or 300 years, that process is stopped due to some reason. But by seeing your institute, I can really know, at least in plant, in agriculture, and of course in many costly things, herbs. If you are growing a saffron in Himachal Pradesh, definitely cost will come down and everybody can use, many people can use it. One more thing is that asafoetida, we are importing from Afghanistan and from Iran. I think that can also be grown in Madhya Pradesh, because you are having the capability to do that type of thing. Your institute is having that type of capability. But let me talk to you in the end that exposure to light in night while awake is such a shift what may be associated with risk of breast cancer, cause of sleeplessness, cause of gastrointestinal problem, for which at present I am suffering, the change of mood and cardiovascular disorders. Because it changes the rhythm of the body. So light has to be, because you are living in the light, everything is growing in the presence of light. We should introduce the knowledge available in the light and develop new knowledge for our agriculture, for our health. Health is very important. Sometime back when this COVID was there, I advised one of my IIT students to measure the temperature of a thumb by non-contacting it. And the work is done. No, this COVID has given you the opportunity, us the opportunity, to think anew about the science in a different way. Character has already told you. So once again, if you are doing it is fine, if you are not doing, I think the scientists in the institute should look into the use of light for plant growth, for house growth, for fruit growth. You know why this saffron is grown? I think the best saffron is grown in Kashmir. Even better than Iran and Spain and other countries. But we should see what are the reasons for that. Is a particular lighting effect is there in that area or not? That has to be analyzed by the scientists and see. In Kinnaur, director, I think, once told me, or I have heard, that they are trying to grow saffron there. But in Shimor also, I think we can. I have roamed around in different parts of Himachal. I like Himalayas, let me tell you. And Himalaya is a magic mountain. Many things are existing there which people don't know. I have seen many herbs in Himalaya. You people might be knowing better because I am only observer. You take few leaves of those plants and your sugar level will immediately come down to 30-40 units. I have seen it myself. The chitraka I have seen was coming from between the two rocks. Many things are there which should be thoroughly studied. And I think our Ayurveda has lost the reason why this medicine is working like this. And that reason we should analyze and find it out. Once again, I would like to congratulate to directors, scientists and students of this institute and staff of this institute for conducting such a beautiful Science Day function. And I think we should make full use of science and technology in biology. At present, yes, let me tell you, there is a very big diversion of the scientists or technologists in the direction of biology. Even mechanical engineers are working in biology. Even the people who are working in light, they're. And thank you very much. I would like to stop at this point.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. I think your advice is really very valuable, and we thoroughly enjoyed and listening about biology from engineers. That was a fantastic experience, and things like, you know, you touch upon importance of light on plant growth and development. You are right that as a biologist we have been doing since long, but the point that you really raise is very pertinent, that you can control growth and development, not only growth and development, but how can we control yield. And I think this is a new dimension that you suggested. Although we had been studying the role of light onto various facets, but I think this is a very new direction. And we'll keep it in mind, sir. And let's see, when you come next time, maybe we give you some result of this. And you mentioned about hing. And I am happy to share with you, sir, that hing we already introduced, sir, in the country. And already our farmers have started cultivation of this important spice. So thank you so much. And I really wonder how you also thought about hing. that was something, you know, very exciting for us to understand. New things you told us about, you know, how one can make one photon into two into four, and which can change frequency of light. I'm sure that, you know, this information, if something is generated, can be very useful for us also. Because sometimes plants do play with light frequencies, and if we have some such parameters, that can be very useful. So thank you very much, sir, for your so valuable suggestion onto the Science Day at our institute. And we look forward at a right time when you can visit to our institute, and we can have more such exposures, more such words of wisdom for betterment of science. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
May I request Professor Vasik to be on the dais? Moving forward, now I request our director, sir, for felicitation of our honorable. So, felicitation of honorable guest with Himachali, cape and shawl, souvenir, and gift pack from IHB. I would also request our director, sir, to pay virtually. Yes, sir.
Sir, although you are not here in person, so all our small mementos for the remembrance, I will ensure that it will reach you. In real sense. Although they brought it here before me on this plate, but we will ensure, sir, that it reaches you. And if you will remember to come here, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much. I would love to come to that place.
Sure, sir. And sir, let me just educate this small moment. We will have all our products, whatever series of products that we have developed. And a small memento, and then typical Himachali shawl and cap, which will always remind you that you know you have been associated and you will continue to be associated with our institute. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Now I will request Professor Chandrasekhar for tea plantation to virtual mode.
Although you know any guest whom we invite, we always request for a tree plantation. You rightly said these are very important for all our present. Since sir, you will not be able to be present in person, so here, our person will let you know how we will do it. We will wait for your permission, sir. Moment you permit, we will click here and on the ground. We will do the plantation on your behalf with your name.
Please do it. Please do it.
So, once you come next time, you will see that this will be there, sir. This plant will be there for you with your name, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now I will request Dr. Vipin Hazan to extend vote of thanks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shashi. Respected chief guest of today's function, guest of honor, Director sir, madam, and ladies and gentlemen, we are highly privileged to have with us Professor Lalit Kumar Avasthi, and a great academician who has contributed immensely towards upliftment of the NITs that he is associated with and other institutes. Thank you for delivering a special talk on fog computing and challenges, sir. You have very rightly described the importance of fog computing and how it differs from the cloud computing, and also the challenges that lie before the computer scientists while developing and using the fog computing systems. So very rightly, sir, you have brought out some of the important issues that are associated with fog computing related to authentication and trust issues, privacy, security, servers, scalability, site selection, and energy consumption. Thank you for guiding us on this topic, sir, which has applications in smart cities, smart grids, vehicles, video streaming, and healthcare. Many of these are associated with applications in biology also. Our scientists and young scholars and staff are immensely benefited by your pioneering thoughts on the topic. Thank you very much, sir, for guiding us. Thanks, special thanks to the guest of honor, Professor Chandrasekhar, a great personality, scientist, and he very told us about how science can actually benefit society, and he described very important areas where we should be focusing on. Sir, your presence is a guiding force for all of us, and it's a lot of motivation for all of us, and we thank you very much for your words of advice and for your gracious presence, sir. Thank you very much. I must thank our director, sir, for motivation and guidance, and Madam Director for her graceful presence during this function. We are highly thankful for the gracious presence of the academicians and the guests from different universities, institutes and organizations who are present here and also connected virtually for this particular celebration. Students and teachers who are connected through virtual platform, especially under the Jigyasa program, are highly thankful. We are very thankful to them. We thank our former colleagues for their presence and blessings. Some of them are present here and others who are connected virtually to us, with us. Thanks to the press and media for their presence and coverage of the this particular National Science Day celebrations. Contributions of the IHVT staff who were actually involved in making various arrangements for today's function in various capacities and committees and groups are gratefully acknowledged. And we thank the audience, scientists, technical staff and scholars, not only the technical and the scientific staff, but also the administrative staff, staff from stores and purchase, from finance. We are thankful to all of them. In the end, I thank one and all for their support and encouragement to make this function a successful event. Thank you one and all. Now, may I request all of you to please rise for the national anthem.